Alrighty, we're going to go ahead and get this going anyway. Not everything's 100% perfect, but that's totally okay. Here you go, Hanno. Please.
Yeah, So apparently this is not my laptop. I agreed to use another laptop, and apparently it's an Apple laptop, and it seems it's difficult to have the same content on the screen of the Apple laptop and the projector. So I might have to turn around during the talk. Yeah, you're here for this TrueCrypt talk, but apparently the clicker also doesn't.
No, the clicker
No, it doesn't. Okay, so the story of this talk is like I asked the people from the Free Software Foundation if I can give a talk in their cluster, and they kind of organized that I could give it here, and then I learned that this is the decentralization cluster, which is kind of a lot of blockchain content, and I thought I cannot give a talk here without addressing that quickly. So. This has nothing to do with TrueCrypt, but I will get to that soon. This is a picture of an opencast coal mine. This is like in eastern Germany in a place called Jenschwalde, which is like, I think, one of the big crimes we do to our planet, which is also reflected like in the motto of this Congress. And there's a very similar mine like this very close to here. If you want to see one, you can get there in like half an hour. So. I just wanted to show you that so you can think about when you're developing technology, if it's really just a good idea to develop technology that's based on burning as much electricity as you can for some kind of, I don't know. Yeah. And I'll give another talk on day four about I will talk more about the climate crisis. So, yeah. Let's start the real talk, but I thought I had to say this. TrueCrypt, if you don't know, it's a crypto software, crypto in the original meaning, not the hijacked meaning of, yeah. It was first released in 2004, and there's kind of a lot of mystery around this software. So, there is an older encryption software, which was called Encryption for the Masses, which is kind of the predecessor of TrueCrypt. And that apparently was developed in part by a guy called Paul LaRue, who he's currently in jail, as far as I understand, and he's been involved in drug dealing and other criminal activity, which like is a lot of potential for conspiracy theories, right? And TrueCrypt contains a lot of the code from the original Encryption for the Masses. The developers of TrueCrypt, they were kind of anonymous. It's not clear if this Paul LaRue guy was still involved in TrueCrypt or not. One question that comes up a bit is, like, is TrueCrypt open source or free software? Often it's called like an open source software, but people are also often sloppy with these terms. And technically, this code has a kind of a non-standard license that has some unusual clauses, and generally, so the Free Software Foundation doesn't consider this as a free license, and it's also not accepted in most Linux distributions that have that only distribute free software. So generally, TrueCrypt, while you can get the source code and you can fork it, but there are some conditions that make it not being free software or open source software. But still, TrueCrypt was quite popular, one of the reasons is that it's relatively easy to use, and a lot of cryptographic software has this reputation that it's all complicated. I mean, if you've tried using PGP, or you know what I'm talking about. These Snowden leaks happened. Like, I mean, I guess you all know that, but Edward Snowden, a former NSA employee, published a lot of documents that indicated that NSA surveillance was much bigger than anyone anticipated, and also that the NSA had tried to subvert encryption standards and has tried to break encryption. So this raised some questions about how much can we trust our cryptographic software. And it also raised questions about TrueCrypt. And in 2013, Matthew Green, he's a famous cryptographer, he said, we need to do something about this. I don't know if I can recommend this TrueCrypt software, if it's safe. And he started basically collecting donations so they could start an audit, a security test of the TrueCrypt software. And the donations came in quickly, and they started hiring a company that was specialized in auditing cryptographic software, and the audit started. Then something kind of unexpected happened. So suddenly there was a message on the TrueCrypt webpage which said, warning, using TrueCrypt is not secure as it may contain unfixed security issues. It's unclear why this happened. It's unclear what security issues they were talking about. Of course, there's a lot of speculation around. One theory I heard was that as this guy who is in jail, he kind of made a deal with the law enforcement that he got a lower sentence. And some people speculate that part of that deal was that he would say TrueCrypt is unsafe because the NSA cannot break it. I'm not sure if I believe in that, but speculations like that are running around. So, so since then there have been no new versions of TrueCrypt. It's not developed anymore. But there are some forks. So people took the source code and developed it on their own, and the most well-known and most popular one is VeraCrypt. The security audit that was started by Matthew Green, that's still finished. This was the so-called Open Crypto Audit Project. And they published two reports, the second one in 2015. And they did not find any severe security problems. But there were a few things that were not so nice, where things were in very unusual situations that could cause a security problem. Then some months later, a guy from Google's Project Zero, James Forshaw, looked at TrueCrypt and found a few more security problems. Also the BSI, which is the German IT security agency, published another audit of TrueCrypt, which is not the audit I'm going to talk about. The vulnerabilities, as far as they are known, VeraCrypt fixed those. So if you're still using TrueCrypt, you should probably switch to VeraCrypt, or should have done that several years ago. Then there was another audit published by an organization called OSTIF. And they audited VeraCrypt particularly and also looked at how these known bugs have been fixed. So let's talk about the BSI. The BSI is the German government security, IT security agency. So if the government has problems with their IT security, which occasionally happens, then the BSI are the people who should care about that, and they also, inform the public about IT security issues. In theory, the role of the BSI is a purely defensive one, which is kind of crucial because we know that there are government agencies who try to use security weaknesses to attack people. There's some conflict of interest here. And this is, I think, something to look at, because very often we have a situation where there are very close ties between government agencies that have a job of attacking people for law enforcement reasons, and on the other hand, government agencies who are supposed to make computers more secure, which is an obvious conflict of interest, right? And the BSI is under the control of the Ministry of Interior, which is also all the spy agencies in Germany and the law enforcement agencies are also under that control. So there's a kind of a connection. It's not only a problem in Germany, of course. Some are also very open about it. The NCSC in the UK, they have it right in their logo that they are part of GCHQ. So you may decide if you want to trust them. Or in Australia, they recently had kind of a scandal because the Australian Cybersecurity Center, they are co-organizing a conference and they uninvited a few people who were talking about whistleblowing and surveillance, and apparently they didn't like it, which may have to do with the fact that they are part of the Australian Signals Directorate. So this is an issue you have in many countries. Recently I learned that the BSI had created an audit of TrueCrypt that was secret for 9 years. It was created in 2010 and was performed by two companies called Zurich and S-Crypt, and was extremely detailed. So it's hundreds of pages. According to the BSI, they tried to communicate the results of these audits to the TrueCrypt Foundation, but they were not interested. And despite all this discussion that I told you about, it seemed like this was 2010, and this initiative by Matthew Green started in 2013, and then there was this mysterious TrueCrypt no longer developed with a strange message. I'm really wondering, like, you have a detailed audit report of a software sitting in your desk, and you learn about all these things, and then you think, we're not going to say anyone anything about that. So why did I learn about this? So there's a web project which is called Frag den Staat, which is very nice. There you can ask government agencies to give you documents. And there's a law in Germany, and there are similar laws in other countries, which is called Informationsfreiheitsgesetz, which translates to something like freedom of information law. And that law says, basically, if the government has a document and you want to see it, then you can get it. There are a few exceptions, unfortunately, but this is the default. So the default situation is, government has a document, you want to see it, they have to give it to you, or they have to have a good reason why they don't give it to you. Which is very nice, and which also not a lot of people know. So this should be more widely known. I think this is a very important thing for government transparency. And on this platform, Frag den Staat, which means like ask the state, there was a user who was sending a very generic request to BSI asking if they have any analysis of TrueCrypt, or if they know anything about a backdoor in TrueCrypt. And surprisingly, he got an answer, and he got these documents. So the BSI sent him parts of this audit from 2010. This was numbered from AP2 to AP6. But they also said that this guy is not allowed to make these documents public due to copyright, which is an unfortunate thing. That this freedom of information law, it's very nice, but the government agencies can give you the documents and can tell you, but we have a copyright on this, so you may not give it to someone else. I mean, everyone else can also send a request to them. There was a previous case where it was also about the BSI document, and where then the people from Frag den Staat, they made a one click, you can request this document too, and they get several hundred requests. We plan to do that as well, but then they changed their opinion. But these documents were numbered from AP2 to AP6. So I was wondering, like, maybe there's something missing. Like, is there an AP1? And then I started reading these documents, and in one of these documents, it said, it's German, so but it doesn't matter. It's referencing AP3 and AP7. So, yeah, where's this AP7? So I sent more requests to BSI, and eventually I got, hopefully, all the documents. So I read most of these documents. interestingly, I really found they were describing bugs that were not fixed for all these 9 years. And also, I asked the developer of VeraCrypt, and he said, yeah, he has never heard about this. And the BSI was never in contact with him. Here's one, the code where one of these bugs is. Anyone see it? What's happening here is, like, we have a function which is it's to execute other applications. And it has an array called args, and then it's checking if this array there's a list arguments passed, and it's checking if this array is smaller or equal to this list that is passed, and then it throws an exception. So here it's checking if all these arguments that are passed fit in this array. And then it's putting the name of the process into that array, and then it's putting the arguments in, and then it's putting a null pointer in. So that is length of the list plus 2. Which means if you have exactly the 31 arguments, then that sums up to 33, but this check doesn't hit and you get an overflow. You get an off by one overflow here. I don't think this is a particularly severe bug, because you would have to have a situation in the code where an application is called with so many arguments, and I didn't find any situation where that would plausibly happen. But still, it's something that you want to fix. Interestingly, in another document, there was it says here that it's German again, but it says we can only list examples here because we haven't analyzed the whole code. And you would expect some examples here, but the chapters with the examples, they are empty. So it seems this document here is somehow unfinished. One speculation I have is that, because this also says off by one overflows, that they wanted to put the bug I just showed you here and then later decided to move that to another document, and that kind of got a confusion here. But I don't know what exactly happened here. So basically what they say here is, yeah, we only can list examples for these vulnerabilities, but then we forgot to list the examples. Then there's a very detailed description how you could use TrueCrypt for privilege escalation. And the thing here is that in Linux, if you run TrueCrypt as a user, you usually cannot mount things, because on Linux you need to be root to mount something. There's a possibility to let call us something which is called the core service of TrueCrypt via sudo and allow the user to execute that with root permissions, and that can mount the partitions for you. But that is not officially supported. That's kind of a hack, but there are web pages that describe how to do this, and this is not secure, which this audit describes. And there are various ways how you can exploit this, but a very easy way is, actually, you can create a binary with a suit flag, which means that when you execute that, it's executed with root permissions. And then you put that on a TrueCrypt container, and then you mount that, and then you execute that and let it open a shell or something. So there's basically no safe way to use TrueCrypt or VeraCrypt where you can let users mount things, and that basically opens up that users can become root. Then there was a longer chapter about memory wiping. So it is a common practice that in cryptographic software, when you use a key or a password or anything else that should be secret, that should not leak, that you delete the memory afterwards. And this is a tricky issue. So there has been a talk last year on the Congress. If you're interested in that particular issue, you should watch that talk, because compilers do optimizations. And if you overwrite memory and then don't use that memory anymore, then the compiler may decide, yeah, we don't need that, we optimize it away. And there are some tricks to avoid that, but yeah. And TrueCrypt and also VeraCrypt has a macro which is called burn, which seems to be fine. So I asked the guy who gave that talk last year if that looks good, and he said it looks good. So I trust that this is safe. But this audit found out that there are a lot of places in the code where this macro is not used where it should be used, where there's key material in variables and they are not overwritten. And here's one example. There's a function doing AES encryption, or decryption in this case, and it has a variable called SS, and I mean, it's you don't have to understand the code, but it is using pieces of the key and temporarily storing it in that SS array. And at the end, it's not deleting that array. So there are pieces of the key ending up in that variable and not are not overwritten. Yeah. So the right thing to do is you add a call to this burn macro for this temporary variable. For some of these, I sent patches to VeraCrypt and they applied them, but not all of them. So plenty of them, there's a long list where they analyzed function by function and said this function is safe, or this function, there's some key material that's not properly overwritten. So if you want to improve VeraCrypt, you can get these documents and look through that list and send patches to VeraCrypt. They will be happy about that. If you want to do that, it's in document AP5, starting page 26. So, yeah. I told you earlier that two companies, one called Styrix and the other Escrypt, performed this audit. One of these companies also created a fork of TrueCrypt, which is called Trusted Disk. I learned about that the day after I published an article about all this. Someone pointed me, there's a press release from this company from a couple of years ago where they mentioned that audit, so then I knew it's this company, and where they also mentioned that they created this fork, and they also announced that they want to publish the source code of that software. But they never did that. The company that got later bought by another company called Rode & Schwarz, and they still sell Trusted Disk today, which is probably illegal, because the TrueCrypt license says this. It says, the complete source code of your product must be freely and publicly available, at least until you cease to distribute your product. Which means, like, Rode & Schwarz, they are distributing that, so they must make available the code for that fork. And they don't. I asked them, I didn't get an answer. In summary, if you tell stories like this, it tends to drive up people's fantasies, where they say, yeah, of course the BSI didn't publish that because they wanted to give the 0 days to their friends at the Verfassungsschutz or the BND or other spy agencies. I don't think that is what's happening here. Particularly, I don't think that because none of the bugs in this audit was severe. Like, these were minor issues where you say it's nicer to fix them, but it's nothing earth-shattering, right? And it's not something where you can say, we have an encrypted TrueCrypt container, now we can break that. There's no bug like that in that audit. I do think that the BSI is a very problematic institution, not just from this thing, and I think they have a mentality of being secretive, which I think is a bad thing for IT security. If there's one thing we learned about IT security is we're trying to be transparent. We're trying to share information, to learn things, to disclose things. I think being a very secretive institution doesn't fit well here and is problematic in general. So that was it. If you want to download these documents, they are here. They are in German, unfortunately. So, yeah. Yeah.
Does anybody have any questions? Oh, sorry. Questions? Yes, we do have one. Coming around with a mic for you.
Thank you for your great talk. Do you have any idea what the difference between the audit from Matthew Green and the BSI audit is, that they found so much more vulnerabilities?
So the audit from Matthew Green, it's focusing a lot on the cryptography because they hired a company that is focused on that. This audit was just extremely detailed. So it's very long. And so I think they found some things that slipped the eyes of others. But I mean, this is no surprise, really. Like, if you do two audits of a software, you will also always find different things. That it would be very surprising if people only find the same things.
Why do you think the BSI invested resources to do this audit? What do you think? Why do you think BSI invested resources to do this audit? What was the reason for it?
So what they told me was that there was a program for basically checking what software the government should use, and in that capacity they thought, should the government use TrueCrypt, and that was the reason.
You just talked about the list of recommended software that governmental agencies should use. Do you know that Trusted Disk is still listed on there and they should use it?
So that's a different thing. So this project that was kind of ended, but there's a list of BSI approved for safe usage software, and this illegal fork of TrueCrypt is on that list.
Did you get the security target of TrueCrypt and verified that the founded errors were mentioned in the security target? So you said that the TrueCrypt guys answered that won't fix the problems.
Yeah.
And they might won't fix the problems because the problems are not covered by the security target, which is on the TrueCrypt page.
So I don't think anyone would say that, like, this buffer overflow I showed, that was clearly a mistake because they tried to catch the buffer overflow but missed it by one index. So I cannot see how you would say that would be by design. And also with the memory wiping, I mean, they had this function. They were using it in some places and not in others. So I also don't think that this was intentional. The thing is, I have not talked to the TrueCrypt authors. I don't know who they are, so I
maybe we can talk later.
Okay, thanks. So you were talking about kind of organizational issues that lead to conflicts of interest between sort of parts of government agencies that are supposed to increase IT security and government agencies who benefit from weak IT security. So I was wondering about your thoughts on this. Have you come across models where this works, where there's a separation of concerns such that there's no conflict?
I mean, we're getting into kind of a big political question here. I'm actually very concerned in general when government thinks that keeping IT security bad is a good idea. Like, I just disagree on that in principle. I think if the government knows about the security problem, they should work on making our IT infrastructure more secure. It would probably be an improvement to have these entities clearly independent.
Thank you so much, Hanno. Let's give him a big hand.